next subject will be catalyst packing characteristics, the influence of size and shape on conversion and pressure drop. It will be presented by Dave Mateer from Harshaw Filtron.
I am Dave Mateer, and I'd like to thank you for having me here today. I'm not going to talk about anything that's radically new or fundamentally insightful about the catalyst. I'd like to present this really to rehash some of the basic information upon which some fixed bed catalyst decisions are made, very important fixed bed catalyst decisions. I'm going to talk about the influence of the catalyst size and its shape on the conversion of the pressure drop, and I'd like to start with a few definitions. Next slide. The aspect ratio is the length of the particle divided by its diameter. And I'm going to demonstrate that this ratio is important in determining how much solids you get into your reactor. The voidage is the unoccupied spaces in the reactor that's filled with the fixed bed catalyst. These are the spaces through which the fluids flow. And consequently, voidage is a very important term in pressure drop considerations. In the laboratory, pressure drop considerations are not very significant. They become very significant, however, when you're running a commercial reactor. And the area is the external catalyst area in the reactor itself. This is a combination of the geometry of the particles and the voidage of the particles. Next slide, please. To demonstrate some of the importance of the specific surface or the external catalyst area that's in the reactor, I performed a fairly simple test. I took one catalytic material, a catalytic precursor, and formed it into several different sizes and shapes. Two sizes of tablets, two sizes of cylindrical extrudates, and two sizes of three-fluted extrudates. These catalysts were tested in a small laboratory reactor, a gradientless backmixed reactor, at test conditions which really amount to a low effectiveness factor for the catalyst. In other words, just essentially the external surface of the catalyst particles were contributing to the reaction. That's a very usual situation for commercial applications. And then what I did is merely figured out what the external catalyst area was in the reactor and plotted the observed conversion relative to the best catalyst, which was the smallest catalyst, against the external catalyst area. This really isn't surprising. All this says is that the external catalyst surface area, almost irrespective of what the shape was really the important thing in determining what the observed conversion was in the test unit. No strange little shape effects or anything that couldn't be explained just from the geometry of the particles. Next slide, please. On the basis of that test work and data reduction, adding a couple of more definitions, the activity of a catalyst, I like to view it as the intrinsic ability of the catalyst to promote the reaction at the test conditions. And conversion is the product of that intrinsic catalyst activity with the area in the reactor. It's important, I believe, to keep these things in mind so that when you're testing catalysts, you clearly differentiate between what is the catalyst's activity and what is the conversion. Next slide, please. The pressure drop, as I said, was an important parameter in commercial applications and actually running large fixed bed units in industry. And this is a very simplified version of the Ergen equation, which is used to calculate pressure drops through beds of packing. And all I've done is taken a lot of the terms that are normally associated with the reactor, the length of the reactor bed, the diameter, and lumped them into constants K1 and K2, and also the fluid terms, the viscosity and density of the fluid. They're also in the constants. Essentially, the Ergen equation assumes that the total pressure drop is contributed to by these two terms, a viscous term, which is energy loss. I like to envision it by the fluid rubbing across the surface of the particles, and an inertial term, which I like to envision as the energy lost when the fluids collide with the particles. From this equation, from the previous work, we know what we need to find out in order to make some comparisons between different catalyst shapes and sizes. We need to find out what the area of the catalyst is in the reactor, and we need to find out what the voidage of the catalyst is in the reactor. So if I can have the next slide. First place first, a little simple geometry. These are specific surface equations for these three different shapes, cylindrical shapes, extrusions or tablets, three fluted extrudates and four fluted extrudates. And simply these equations tell you how much external area is associated with each individual piece. It's interesting to note that in the case of cylindrical shapes, when your length is equal to your diameter, as it would be for a tableted material, the equation reduces to the same area to volume equation that you would get for a sphere. And spheres are also described by that equation. So that's a good start. We have a way to calculate the area of the individual pieces. We have to know what the total volume of solids would be in the reactor then to calculate what the total area of the catalyst in the reactor is. Next slide. I did a little bit more work, and this is where our aspect ratio begins to show up. I took one sample of very long cylindrical extrudates. These were 1/32nd inch extrudates with a small diameter, very carefully handled, so we managed to get a very long extrudate out of our dryer. I measured a packed bed density by filling a graduated cylinder with the 1/32nd inch extrudates and tapping it repeatedly until there was no further settling. I have a little machine that does this for me. And then measured that a packed density, and before I had tapped it down, I measured a loose density. Then I sized the extrudates with a sophisticated rolling pin, plastic bag, screened them to remove fines, and repeated it. A loose density and a packed density in a graduated cylinder. Sized them again, so I had a set of 5 data points. From the particle density and the packed and loose densities, I was able to calculate what the voidage was in the graduated cylinders. The voidage varied very directly with the aspect ratio. And in fact, at an aspect ratio of 1, which would be for the case of a tablet, these extruded, the curves generated from these extrudates extrapolate to about 0.43 voidage for loose packed tablets and 0.35 voidage for a bed of tablets that has been packed until it will no longer settle. That's very good for cylindrical extrudates, but the question, of course, is does it fit tablets? Does it fit fluted extrudates? Next slide. Yes, it does. Tablets and fluted extrudates were analyzed in much the same way. The loose density point for tablets and this particular loose voidage point for extrudates were measured off of large commercial reactors that were actually filled. They're of course not packed densities. Loose densities are always somewhat subjective, but I feel that the method that I use for measuring loose density does give me a pretty good number. And then, of course, I had some loose density measurements in the lab. So we see that the relationships established for the cylindrical extrudates correctly extrapolate to the values for the tablets and also describe the voidage versus aspect ratio for fluted extrudates. So now we know what the voidage is for different aspect ratio catalysts. And we know from the equations that I put up before how to calculate the external area of one particular piece. Using these two pieces of information together, Then we can start to calculate the total amount of area in a reactor and make some educated estimates as to what the pressure drop would be in a commercial reactor for certain catalysts, comparing one case to another. In this case, I've used loose voidages for estimating the relative area and the relative pressure drops. I do that because we supply catalysts in large quantities to commercial customers, and I like to think about their needs. Also think about the needs of the people in the labs. But for them, the pressure drop is really quite important for the commercial users. For in the lab, or in testing in a fixed bed unit in the lab, the relative area term is going to be important. Interestingly enough, if you run the same sort of a table and get up off of the particle size equations and the voidages for a packed case, the relationships are very, very close. I selected as a base case a 1/8 inch tablet, the loose voidage of about 42% in the bed, and just arbitrarily assigned that 100% relative area that would be in the bed, either a test unit or a large commercial reactor. And then calculating, estimating the pressure drops, or just setting them at both limits, the limit of the inertial pressure drop and at the limit of the viscous pressure drop, equal to 100%. Now, when we compare different sizes and shapes against that base case, we start to see some interesting things. A lot of people might assume that testing of 1/8 inch extrudates would be comparable to 1/8 inch tablets. However, that really doesn't turn out to be the case. Because the extrudates are longer, you have a higher voidage. That means that you have less catalyst in the reactor. And consequently, you have less external catalyst area in the reactor. In fact, you have only about 2/3 as much external area with 1/8 inch extrudates as you do with 1/8 inch tablets. So a more valid test for comparing in the laboratory the activity of a 1/8 inch tablet versus an extruded catalyst would be to test a 1/8 inch three-fluted extrudate. In that case, in spite of the voidage difference, you will end up with almost identical external catalyst areas in your laboratory test reactor. And then you don't have to do quite as much data reduction in taking these observed conversions from your test unit and trying to figure out which is actually the better catalyst. That's good for comparing catalyst A versus catalyst B in the lab. In selecting a replacement catalyst for a commercial unit, the plant manager may want to know a little bit more about it, other than will it just make the product I need it to make? Can I run it? That's a very important question. And he might get a little put off if you would recommend a small size extrudate to replace a large size tablet that he's currently running. But actually, it's a valid recommendation to a degree. Because of the higher voidage in the beds of extrudates, you have more flow channels in the bed. And consequently, you can run a higher external catalyst area at about the same pressure drop. Most commercial reactors run near this limit, the inertial limit, which really amounts to, just look at the velocity of the fluids through the bed, a fast flow rate of fluids through the bed. A viscous limit would correspond to a slow flow rate of fluids through the bed. Most commercial reactors like to run fast flow rates. So actually, you can substitute a 1/16 inch extrudate for a 1/8 inch tablet, probably have no pressure drop problem at all, and enjoy the benefits of a greater external catalyst area in the commercial reactor. Also, in some cases, a commercial reactor may run with a very high amount of recycle, and conversion is really not a problem, but pumping so much recycle liquid around is very expensive. In that case, an extrudate could be substituted with, for instance, the exact same external area, but only about two-thirds of the pressure drop through the reactor as compared to a 1/8-inch tablet. So some intelligent catalyst decisions can be made for the support of a commercial reactor based on some of this information. And intelligent decision-making can be made on the evaluation of test data from small fixed-bed units in your lab on the basis of the relative area information. This table is effectively my summary.
Other questions?
Do you have copies of the tables, or is that part of a Biltrow pamphlet?
You can contact Bruce Williams, I'm sure
you can.
He's our
there
sir.
I might have some with
him. He'll get you a card. It's
all planned.
Now, I want to make a point. These numbers are not chiseled in stone. Can we back up one slide, please? The numbers were generated assuming that the extrudates have an aspect ratio of between 2.5 and 3, which corresponds to a loose voidage of about 0.49, or a packed voidage of about 0.42. If the sample of extrudates that you have in your test unit are unusually long, you'll have a higher voidage. You've got to compensate for that. If they're unusually short, you'll have a lower voidage, and you have to compensate for that too.
Well, that's low aspect ratio.
I'm not sure. If for instance you made a tablet that was shorter in length than it is in diameter, I'm not sure if you should actually turn it around and look at the actual diameter as being the length, the length as being the diameter. We do make some products like that, and I haven't really looked at them too deeply. Because they're relatively minor product lines.
Dave, but that was an important development of 1/16-inch extrudate reforming catalyst in the early 50s. And Baker and Company ended up making the 1/16-inch extrudate for this reason. Exxon and Davison, realizing this phenomenon and not having extruded equipment, made reforming catalysts of tablets that were very thin. They were less than about 16th of an inch thin. I think they were about a quarter of an inch in diameter. So they tried to get at this packing factor by essentially coming out of that aspect ratio some more down to maybe a half or something like that.
Well, sometimes with very unusual shapes, you can get into some unusual characteristics. For instance, a thin wafer like that may not pack very regularly at all. And I've neglected to talk at all in here about rings, because the Ergen equations accept rings. Is one of the shapes that it really describes. That's because you're never sure how much of the fluid flow is proceeding around the form and how much is proceeding through the hole in the middle. So there are interesting arguments that can be made about rings, but they don't fit very neatly into this talk.
What importance is you can measure the external area of your catalyst in the reactor, or how many pounds of the reactor?
No, there's a difference. The external area is going to be, it's going to depend on the pounds of catalyst that you put in the reactor, and then the particle density of the material. If you put in equal volumes of, say, a low-density alumina versus a high-density copper-chromite catalyst, you may load exactly the same external area, but tremendously different weights of catalyst.
What your 1/8-inch tablets versus 1/16-inch free fluids, mm-hmm. you have the same external area, higher voidages, therefore if you put the same kind of base, then you have less catalyst in there.
The initial activity would still be the same. For test unit purposes, the activity would still be the same. If the catalyst poisons by a strong adsorbing poison, you may benefit from running a tableted form where you can actually put more catalytic material into the reactor to accommodate the poison and stay on stream longer. However, there are differences in the poison tolerance of tablets versus extrudates over and above just the weight of material that's loaded into the reactor.
Hey, how big a tube did you use to measure this?
I used a truncated 1 liter graduated cylinder in measuring the 1/32nd inch extrudates. It's important that whatever vessel you're measuring your densities in be at least 10 times the size of the particles that you're measuring it in. Otherwise, you begin to get wall effects and you don't get a true measurement of your packed density. And of course, in the case of the loose tablets and one of the loose fluted extrudates, those were in the vicinity of 500 to 700 cubic feet, commercial reactors.
I can see why the external area in the buoys would be very convenient things to use for calculating the pressure drop and very good things to use, but I think surely an awful lot of reactions that you do in catalytic reactors don't proceed at Thiele moduli that are very high, very low effectiveness factors. I think a lot of them have intermediate to very high effectiveness factors, and so I think the situation to calculate conversion based on this criteria is much more complicated.
Most fixed bed units that I'm familiar with run at low effectiveness factor.
I could show you papers on cold liquid hydrotreating, which you would think could certainly proceed at low effectiveness factor, and that's not the consensus.
Well, if you have a very active catalyst, it's almost going to naturally proceed at a low effectiveness factor. And the way you can get to a high effectiveness factor is to cut down on your inlet temperature to that catalyst until your diffusion can catch up with your.
No, there are a lot of things you can do from reactor and catalyst point of view, but I think generally it doesn't work that easily.
Are there any other questions? Thank you.
The next paper from Ashland Petroleum is entitled Turbine Fuels from Western Kentucky Tar Sands Bitumen. The presenter is Alan Johnson, and co-authored by H.F. Moore and W.A. Sutton and R.M. Benson.
Alan? I can negotiate the spaghetti. Thank you. Ready if you are. This paper was given last week at the ACS National Meeting in Denver. And what you will see here is a bit of a change from that. I told someone earlier that if you think you've seen all of this, be sure to take notes because we have a quiz at the break. You may not see it at all. Contract to the Air Force, and the contract lasted from July of 83 to July of 86. And there were three phases to the contract. Phase one was a preliminary process analysis. And phase two was a laboratory sample preparation. And phase three was a pilot plant sample prep. To get the good word in for the guys there at Wright Aeronautical. Okay. Some of the objectives of the program were to develop the cost, the yield, chemical properties, and physical characteristics of turbine fuels that were produced from tar sands. We had several goals, among which were to optimize the processing scheme, to produce sample quantities of JP4 and 8, and achieve a minimum of 70% of energy efficiency. I think most of you know the problems that we're having today in crude oil supply. Energy Secretary John Harrington said just recently about a DOE supply and demand report, there's a need to strengthen the U.S. oil and gas industry and reduce our growing dependence on insecure imported oil, end quote. The report further pointed out that by the year 2000, we would be from one half to two thirds dependent upon imported oil at the rate we're going today. So we do have a problem. There is a disappearance of paraffin-based light crudes. We're using the heavier sour crudes. There's competition for the naphtha fraction, petrochemicals, plastics, gasoline. And we have a dependence upon the overseas sources for a substantial supply of crude. Now, tar sands, on the other hand, are very plentiful in the United States. And this is the tar sands distribution as of the Lewin and Associates report of about 2 years ago. You can see that Utah has by far the largest amount. The Alaska is speculated because there's so much crude oil in Alaska. They assume that we have a lot of tar sands. Alabama measured reserves is better now than it was at that time. They discovered more. Texas has quite a bit. California has quite a bit of tar sands and heavy oils. Kentucky has more than you would imagine. And then the other sources there are Kansas, Missouri, Oklahoma, Wyoming, New Mexico. Now, there's a difference between crude oils and tar sands bitumen, and I'll try to explain to you a little bit here. The crude oil viscosity is less than 10,000 centiforces in place. Conventional crude has an API greater than 20. Heavy crude has an API range of 10 to 20. And extra heavy crude has an API less than 10 degrees. And the good old bitumen viscosity is greater than 10,000 centipoises. There's some other adverse characteristics of the tar sands bitumen. It has very high metals, particulate, and water content. It has a high sulfur and nitrogen content. Carbon residue is high. Asphaltene content with the associated nickel and vanadium is high. There are low natural yields of naphtha and distillate. And the API gravity is such that it's very difficult to handle, and it's very low hydrogen content. The source of our Western Kentucky tar sands is from Edmondson and Logan counties. We got our sample from the Kenson Tar Project located in Edmondson County. And you can see that there are approximately 3 billion barrels in place in those two counties. The outcroppings of tar sands occur all the way from Indiana down to that area. That's about 2 billion barrels in Edmondson County and about 1 billion barrels in Logan County. We call our sample a Western bitumen, and it was very aromatic. It has a lot of polynuclear aromatics associated with it. I wanted mainly for you to look at the API gravity. That's near the gravity of water. So conventional desalting would just about be impossible. You can see the hydrogen content is very low at 11%. Nitrogen and sulfur contents are moderate. The oxygen content could be due to the method of production. It was by a combination of steam flood, fire flood. K factor is very low. And remember the Ramsbottom carbon content of 11%. That's pretty high residual carbon content. The poor point was we were able to deal with it, but it was very high. There's virtually no virgin turbine fuel in the West Convention. So we can't just distill some of it out. And roughly half of it boils from 600 to 1,000 degrees. There are a lot of salt and some inorganic solids that are associated with the material. Some of the things we had to deal with, right at first, with the trace metals. The range there is shown because we got the material in drums. and each drum sampled a little bit differently. So we just gave you the whole range. As you know, the nickel vanadium especially act as catalyst poisons in FCC work. The other things, the sodium also is a poison, and various and sundry other materials will give you a lot of problems. So what we decided we wanted to do with it was to use the Ashland approach to solving these problems, which is the carbon rejection in the ART unit, followed by a boiling range conversion in the RCC unit, followed by hydrotreating to upgrade the materials. As you can see, the ART unit is listed first. It uses an adsorbent rather than a catalyst. It has very low catalytic activity. The main thing you want to do there is take the metals out to predict the cracking catalyst, which is contained in the RCC unit. In the RCC unit, we used a typical reduced crude cracking catalyst with a high metals tolerance in case we get any metals through. There is a recycle stream going from the hydrotreatment here back to the feed, which acts as a diluent. The diluent was hydrotreated to a tetralene-type molecule, which is primarily there, which gives you some hydrogen donor capability through the ART and the RCC unit. The hydrotreatment was done with a conventional nickel moly catalyst in all cases, so we would have a high saturation activity. You can see we made products of JP4, JP8, gasoline, and a fuel oil. Not shown on this slide would be the things associated with the commercial unit. We did not use this part of the process in our sample preparation, but in the commercial design we do. And that includes an alkylation unit, a hydrogen unit, and a sulfur recovery unit. In the ART unit, what we try to do is remove the metals, which we can do at 96-99%. We want to minimize the conversion, but we want to remove all of the rim's bottom carbon coat. So we operate at a conversion that will give us a coat content of about 11%. So the coat make there would assure us that we would get all of the carbon residue out, and we don't want to make too much though, because that begins to give you problems in regeneration. The remainder of the yield structure can be taken off of the curves that we've generated at different parameter variations during the different runs in the pilot plant. So we predicted a commercial unit would make 11% coke on catalyst. And then the other yields would follow. A low naphtha make, a pretty good distillate make, and a fairly decent slurry make. We want to minimize the amount of gas, which we feel like we did using the hydrogen donor solvent. It seemed like it did decrease it somewhat. You can see it's a low conversion, about 23%. Then in the RCC unit, we wanted to maximize our total transportation fuel. So we operated at a conversion level that would give us a maximum total transportation fuel. Here we got a little over 7% coke on catalyst. Conversion over 57%. And naphtha make over 33%. Pretty good distillate make. And a fairly low slurry make. We're pretty satisfied with that. In hydrotreating the recycled material, we call it diluent, we found that we needed to go to a relatively high pressure for our thinking, 1,500 pounds, a fairly high temperature. We wanted to run somewhere between 12 and 12.4% hydrogen content, but that seemed to be just about impossible for us to maintain. So we were content to run a little bit lower hydrogen content, which meant that later on in our JP4 and JP8, we would probably be forced to hydrotreat a little more severely. We found that we could hydrotreat the a JP4 precursors to make the 13.6% hydrogen content at one space at about 700 degrees. We were pretty successful in doing that. Hydrogen uptake on JP8 was a different story. Because of the low hydrogen in the recycled material, we needed to increase it by almost 2%. So in our parameter variation runs at 700 degrees and a half space, we didn't quite make it, but we decided that we could run at about 2,000 pounds in our final run to make the hydrogen content, and we were successful with that pressure. We made four different samples of JP4. We had four different target aromatics contents. They were 15, 25, 30, and 35. And we varied the severity using the same feedstock for each sample. And as you can see, we achieved what we set out to do. There's 25% max volume percent aromatics in the mill spec. We knew that if we made 25% on the dot, that we wouldn't make the other specs because of the naphthenic nature of the material. So our 15%, actually 16.9 sample, turned out to meet all the specs, and we were very pleased with that. The gravity is just a little bit on the low side of the API, so the density is slightly high, which gives you a measure of the naphthenic content of the material. Then as we went higher in aromatics, you can see almost a linear response in everything there. The hydrogen goes down almost linearly. The smoke point changed almost linearly. And the gravity changed almost linearly. The more aromatic we got, of course, the more we approached a high-density fuel. In our JP8, we were not able to make the hydrogen spec unless we cut the distillation slightly. And we cut about 70 degrees off of the high end of the distillation in order to make complete specs on it. And as you can see, at 12% aromatics, and we targeted here again for 15, and the API gravity is low. Freeze point's no trouble. Now with the aromatics content, your freeze point will always be extremely low. Heat of combustion was very good, but the hydrogen content we barely made. We also barely made. It shows you that if we had been able to go to a more aromatic fuel, that we would have had a very high density. And it would also show you the extreme naphthenic nature of the material. Another thing we wanted to do was look at the economics. These are $1,983. If we stuck with the specification for hydrogen content in the current mill spec for JP8, the total cost of the fuel is $43.83 a barrel, which is very high. However, if the hydrogen specification were relaxed just slightly, like maybe the 13.3, and then the turbine fuel cost would drop to about $37. And this shows you that if we do go to a little more aromatic fuel, a little higher density fuel, there's a possibility of reducing the cost. We did a lot of other economic studies, and I won't go into the boring details of that today. The process works, shows excellent potential for the production of all fuels, but especially transportation fuels. We can tailor the process to make JP4 or JP8 and maximize those if we want to. At present, conditions, the crude availability, make this option very uneconomic in today's market. density, low-cost fuels are available are reducing hydrogen content specification. There's one in there I missed. I didn't intend to kill that one. The quality of the fuel is very good. The jet type results on all the fuels was zero increase in pressure drop and no coloration on the tubes. So we felt like we accomplished our purposes completely. I'll be glad to answer any questions I can. If you have some simple questions, I'll refer them to my chauffeur back here in the corner.
Price of crude was in 83 and correlate with your cost that you
cost of
cost of crude in 83 you said that we're 83
cost of crude in 83 was pretty close to that.
Yeah. Okay.
And in 83 we felt like we had a fairly economic process, but with the decline in cost of crude right now, it's got to be a process that we would hang on to only in case of emergency.
The other thing is, too, that we were costing bitumen under that economic analysis of $20 a barrel. There's no way in the world that the value would be.
That's my short one. Thank you.
We're a little bit ahead of schedule, but we'll have a break now and come back at 3 o'clock for the next day.
You came down last month? I was going to, but I didn't like it. I was going to, but I didn't make it. I had to get up then this morning at 5:30.
How are you doing right now?
Starting to feel it.
Let's begin in the final part of today's symposium. We will start out with a paper from the U.S. Industrial Chemicals Company in Cincinnati. And the title is Isomerization of Internal Enolic Ethers to Terminal Ethers. And the author is Ronnie Dean.
Well, I'm not really sure how I put this paper into the program, since it doesn't involve either heterogeneous catalysis or petroleum or tar sands. So I'd like to, I guess I'm the token homogeneous catalysis person. So the organizers can say they have a well-rounded program. So, at any rate, I'd like to thank them for the opportunity to talk about my work. At USI, we've had a program for a while looking into the uses of butadiene, what types of chemicals we can make from butadiene that would be interesting industrial chemicals. And the focal point of very much of our work has been this polymerization reaction of butadiene, in which 2 moles of butadiene and 1 mole of methanol go to make methoxyoctadiene. And this is a very fast reaction. It's very easy to run, and if you consider all the things that could happen, it's pretty selective. So for that reason, we were interested in increasing that selectivity even more. This 3-methoxyoctadiene isomer is not as useful for what we want to make as this 8-methoxy isomer. So we went into, we sat down and thought out one day that it would be nice if we could rearrange the 10 to 15% of this undesired isomer to the 8-methoxy isomer that is more useful. Now, looking back into the literature, nobody had ever rearranged alkyl ethers like this. There was a paper using a palladium homogeneous catalyst where the either a phenoxy ether or an acetate, an allylic acetate, was rearranged through this, well, just an allylic rearrangement to put the functional group on the end of the molecule where we want it. So we first thing we did was to try that homogeneous palladium catalyst of a phosphate complex. That didn't work for our particular reaction. Going on a little further, we did discover now a copper-based system, cupric chloride, with or without palladium chloride. Gives us a very nice rearrangement. This is an equilibrium reaction. We started with both isomers, and we go to the same isomer distribution. And it's about two-thirds of the 8-methoxy isomer, and about about a third of the 3. There are some byproducts formed. You can cleave out this methanol from this and get an octatriene, or you can replace this methoxy group with a chloride, since we are running in a chloride system. So you either get octadienyl chlorides or octatrienes as byproducts that decrease the selectivity. So we looked at several of the reaction parameters that that affect this. One of the first things we looked at was the copper concentration. And we found that at 100 degrees with a set palladium concentration, if we doubled that copper concentration, the time required to reach 60% conversion, which is getting pretty close to the equilibrium value, decreased dramatically. However, because of the increased chloride concentration in our system, we also saw an accompanying decrease in the selectivity of the reaction. So the next parameter we looked at was temperature. And back up just a moment, I should explain, these were all run in a Teflon line stirred reactor, stirred autoclave, and we sampled every 15 minutes and followed the reaction so we could determine the 60% conversion time. So anyway, looking at the temperature effect, we saw an increase in the conversion rate between 100 and 125 degrees, and not really any increase in the rate when we went to higher temperatures. And between 100 and 125 degrees, we didn't really see any change in the selectivity. Although when we went to higher temperature, we did see some decrease in the selectivity of the reaction, probably because we're getting more octatriene and more splitting out of the methanol. So one of the other parameters that we looked at was the palladium concentration. Again, you can see we're using fairly small amounts of palladium compared to copper, so copper seems to be the active component. Doubling the amount of copper, or doubling the amount of palladium, increased the reaction rate slightly, but didn't really seem to have much of an effect on the selectivity. Now we tried the palladium chloride alone without the copper and got absolutely no catalytic activity. So the copper, again, seems to really be the active component of this, and the palladium is just activating this copper catalyst. So we looked at the effect of not adding any palladium at all. With no palladium, the reaction is quite a bit slower. We just looked at the 50% conversion number here. It was somewhat slower. We're getting better selectivities now. We add the palladium chloride, the reaction speeds up and selectivity decreases just very slightly. So since we've got, I think this is about a 12-to-1 copper to palladium ratio, we again see that this small amount of palladium has an activating effect. But we were already at some close to the optimum concentration when we first started looking at this. So we did look at the temperature effect of just the copper system itself. Again, we see between 125 and 150 degrees, we really don't see any effect on the rate of the reaction. Time to 50% conversion is the same. But we do see a decrease in the selectivity when we go to a higher reaction temperature. We haven't gone back and looked at the 100-degree point, that might give us even higher selectivity. We haven't really gone back to fully explore this yet. So this led us to try to speculate about what the active catalytic species might be. Again, I mentioned cupric chloride alone does this reaction. Plating chloride alone doesn't. Plating chloride with a phosphine to get it into solution does not make the reaction go. One of the things we suspected was this cupric complex, which is the methanol carbonylation catalyst to give you dimethyl carbonate. So we made this complex and tried that, and that had absolutely no activity for the reaction. So what we have best been able to come up with to date as an active complex is either a cuprous methoxide, or in the case of added plating chloride, you have a complex of this type where the plating chloride actually acts as a ligand. Unfortunately, it's an expensive ligand, but we have plating chloride acting as a ligand from copper, and somehow this activates that copper complex to make the reaction go faster. So to try to explain all this, we have a potential mechanism for what's going on here. We think that you're actually forming a complex of this type. We can see that if you split out your metal complex in this direction, you would go to give you your 8-methoxy octadiene isomer. And if you split it out in the other direction, you simply go back to the 3-methoxy isomer. And one other piece of data we have that tends to support this type of intermediate is if we run this reaction instead of in methanol, if we run it in ethanol, we get the ethoxide equivalent, the ethoxy octadiene instead of methoxy octadiene. So there is some intermolecular mechanism going on rather than an intramolecular rearrangement. So we feel like this explains that with the data we have to date. Without the palladium, you have this type of complex. When you coordinate the chloride to the copper in this manner, you're increasing the electron density inside this metallocycle intermediate, which evidently probably helps to form that intermediate and then allows it to fall apart to give us our final products. So I'd like to thank USI for giving me the opportunity to present this work today. I especially want to thank one of my colleagues, Jack Flytek, who helped me a lot in discussions on working out the mechanism, and I'd like to thank you for your attention.
It's time for questions. Did you try to do this reaction in any other polar solvent like THF or see what happens if there's only intermolecular rearrangement?
No, we've only tried it in methanol and ethanol. I expect that any active hydrogen solvent you can also get to exchange like we did the ethanol. And this might be something interesting to look at. You might be able to form some other more useful intermediate by doing that. But we've never tried the more polar solvent. Since the methanol does seem to come off, I expect you might slow the rate down if you did that.
Do I understand that you, by forming this complex, are able to exceed the equilibrium amount of the...
No, we always come to an equilibrium.
So it is just to the equilibrium.
Yeah, that's why I picked the numbers for the conversion, so we didn't... we're not going to go much higher than the 50 or 60% conversion. In fact, that's a time to reach equilibrium. Any other questions? Thank you.
paper this afternoon. It's from the Kentucky Laboratory. The title is C14 Tracer Studies of Fischer-Tropsch Synthesis. The authors are Lee Min Tao, H. DeBage, and S.Q. Bao. And I should, I guess, introduce Dr. Tao here for presenting.
Sorry for you guys. You, after a long day, you still have to put up with me. Well, me too. My English is no good. Okay. If you have any question you don't understand, just stop me and ask me. Okay. The topic of today is C14 tracer studies of fischer-tropsch synthesis in a slurry reactor. Here are my colleagues, and we come from Kentucky Energy Center. Excellent. Fischer-Tropsch reactor, everybody knows, just a CO hydrogenation. And let's put a very common way is this generally accepted mechanism, which CO can be solved on the surface and somehow form intermediate. Then it has two ways to go. One is go to the next higher hydrocarbon, or it goes through the termination step to form product. In here, X is the chain propagator. Y0 is the chain initiator, and Y is surface reaction intermediate. Okay, no, I haven't gone that far, please. I want to go fast, but not that fast. Thank you for helping me. The reason this mechanism has been generally accepted because when you plot carbon number versus mole fraction of each carbon, in a semi-log paper, you will get a so-called Anderson-Schultz flow rate plot. Okay, the slope of this is R alpha, which represents the Kp over Kp plus Kt. Excellent, please. Excellent. Usually, you will see there's only one alpha value. However, the real world is not that simple. Back a long time ago, people thought there may be more than one alpha. One alpha, more than one alpha certainly implies there may be more than one reaction mechanism going on there. Okay, back in 1980, Professor Satterfield inserted a few about this topic again, and he showed a lot of evidence. Here's one of his papers. He used the ASF plot, again, carbon number versus mole fraction in a semi-log paper. Okay, he found this, that oxygenated compound just go straight line. Okay, olefin compound goes straight line. However, paraffin doesn't. Okay, somehow come to somewhere around C10, C11, it tilted up. All right, and which about the total fraction tilted up too. Okay, he assigned the first one is alpha 1 and the second one is alpha 2. What he's trying to say is there are two alpha values. And he implies there are probably two chain growths going on there. He's not only one. There's another guy from Wojciechowski or something like that. In Canada, he presents pretty much the same thing. Olefin goes straight line, but paraffin tilted up somewhere around C10, C11. And the total organic compound you plot, ASF plot, you get this kind of shape. So now we do have a question there. Okay, we do think there's some kind of things happen which cause this change, but the people, they did work, they only think there's two alpha, they don't give further evidence. What we are going to do, we are trying to use C14 isotope to find out what's going on, is there really two alpha or not. Please, next slide. Okay, don't worry about those crabs around here. I'm going to concentrate this two plot over here, okay? In here, somehow, if we can find a way to add radioactive chain propagator over here, see, every time you add one more in here, see, here, for example, you only add one radioactive compound. Here, you add another. So, per mole wise, when the carbon number increases, you will see the radioactivity will increase, right? Okay, this is one case. If you can find some chain propagator goes in there as a monomer, get in here and make it goes up. On the other hand, you can find some other compound, it oxygenated or olefin or something, which let it can be swapped on the surface, then somehow it's transferred to form surface intermediate. And from then on, just keep going, because you have no way to add more. You just keep constant radioactivity in there. Therefore, when you make a plot, you will find out carbon number versus carbon 14 per mole, just keep constant. Of course, again, this is theoretical value based upon one alpha value. However, in the real case, it's more complicated. So this is not going to give you this kind of information. But based upon this knowledge idea, we're going to pursue further. Please, next slide. All right, our operating conditions like that, we get fused ion catalysts for united catalysts, and our operating temperature is 260 degrees. Centigrade pressure is 100 psi. We operate in the slurry react, and our slurry is octacosine here. Next slide, please. Okay, here's our flow diagram. Very simple. CO hydrogen come in. If I want to put some radioactive compound, I just pump it in through this pump. In this in this presentation, I only give you the information about pentanol pumped in information. Okay, that means I pump in pentanol about 1% volume. Percent into syn gas stream and come to the reactor, react and come out. We can collect the liquid sample by put some trap over there, or we can analyze all of them. Okay, depends what we need and what we want. Please, next slide. Okay, here's the spectra we got. Okay, this reaction is CO hydrogen with the C5 labeled alcohol. Okay, which this radioactive compound is labeled in the alpha position. All right, the top one is proportional counter spectra, and the bottom one is gas chromatography GC spectra. Okay, the area under the proportional counter is proportional to the intensity which carbon 14 you have in there. For example, this first peak is CO. Well, you don't expect there's, when you put C5 alcohol there, you don't expect CO have some radioactivity. That's why it doesn't have radioactivity. Here, if you are interested, I'm going to answer that question later on. Let's concentrate on 5 and 7, okay? Because when you put C5 alcohol in there, you expect somehow C5 alcohol will chemisorb, then come into surface intermediate, then keep going through the chain growth, right? So you expect C5, 6, 7 have radioactivity. Yes, they do. Okay, they do have radioactivity here. The reason C5 has small is not it is small because I use attenuation, which is 5, which is much higher than those. So now if I make a calculation, compare C5, C6, C7, and ask C7 as a basis 1, then I found certain PC over GC means the radioactivity per mole wise. Okay. You will find well, you can argue it's constant or decreasing, okay. I don't want to argue here. Let's go to the next slide and see what's going on, please. Okay,